I'm ready if you are. A very good beginning. I didn't realize until I sat down. I have played this for the introduction. Let's see, like this. Let you be all the. It makes an introduction. There is no introduction to the score. So I think what we played before just makes no sense, does it? No, I mean, it does. I mean, it does in the opera. It makes sense because it comes from what is before. But abstracted, it just doesn't make any sense. So I just invent something that makes a couple of bars so you're in the right key. And end with 5-7 or end with 1. It doesn't matter. What's this all about?
I'm Loretta. And
oh, we know that. Don't tell us all that. That's opera history class. That's a big bore. And just so we don't want to know about that.
I'm just trying to convince my dad. We want the truth. In the song, I'm trying to convince my dad to help my beloved's family rewrite the will so that we are included in it and we get money and then my beloved's family will accept us.
Okay. You're telling us. That's kind of the story of the opera, which is not what I wanted at all. But I think what you have to all have to learn to do is the words of the arias which you sing, word by word by word. So that when you say them, they make some kind of sense to your voice and to your face and to the public. We don't have to know the whole story of the opera. It's nice to know, I'm glad you know. But that's not necessary. But when she sings to her father, we have to know what the words themselves say. That's what I mean. That's what we all have to do that. I do it too. I live with the dictionaries next to every place, not every place, but many places where I sit in the house. So when I think of something, I can look it up. I learned this years ago. I thought, I'll look it up when I go upstairs to the study. Then I found out by the time I got up there, when I did go, I had forgotten. So I thought it's cheaper with Amazon.com, it's all cheap. You just order another dictionary and keep it by the dining room table. There you are. Keep one next to my bed. So I have them where I need them. That's vital. You know, we think about things. I wish I knew that. So look it up. There you are. It's all there for all of us. It's all in the book. It's easy. Not easy, but it's all there. So that's what you have to do with it. All of you have to, who sang earlier this morning too, Look up every word. Don't take anything for granted. Some people write very good translations. I'm not criticizing them at all. But it's impossible. I have yet to see a translation that really does justice to every word that is there that we have to see. It's not possible. Because it doesn't all make sense to put it in English. It doesn't have to make sense, but it has to go into our heads and into our throats, this word or this syllable, so that when we say it, I think when we had Ryu before, perché living ancora, I mean, I think it's almost always translated to the future tense, which it isn't. It's present subjunctive. That he might, that he may conquer again. That's really what she is thinking. Now, I don't know if when you sing, if that's going to be any different, going to sound any different. Perhaps not. But I think it's vital that you who sing it and know that that's different. Perché he vinca ancora. That's present subjunctive. And to know that, and to know what present subjunctive means, that it's not future tense. That's just vital. And all of you who sing, all of you, what you learn in your lives, maybe 100 songs, maybe, in arias. I mean, that's already a big amount. And so what's that to learn that by heart? Nothing. Nothing at all. What if you had to learn the Heidelberg Catechism? And that's boring. This is, we're talking about beautiful music. So, I mean, it's just vital for all of us. I mean, look in the dictionaries. And now, especially now with Google, it's so easy. I mean, we can look up. I'm just amazed when I put things in Google and what it tells me. It tells me things that the dictionary doesn't tell me. I'm just so happy. It's so easy. It's for all of us. But let's try to say, oh, mio. But what kind of singing do we want this to be?
Operatic.
Well, yes, it'll be operatic, but that really doesn't answer my question really well.
Connected?
Yeah, well, that's vital. That's life. It's going to be legato, that's life. We cannot live without that. There is no singing without it. There's no real singing. But, oh, it just wants to be beautiful, doesn't it? You're just speaking to your father. Oh, mio babbi. I mean, I've spoken to people, they're not even aware of what babbino is.
Oh, my dearest daddy.
Yeah, okay. So that's, you're speaking to your father, and so you want it to be really nice. Oh, mio babbino caro. Then sing, come on, let's. And I think, if I were gonna play those, I don't think I would do it up an octave as you did, I don't know. It's just made believe, anyway.
Yeah.
You make believe what you want.
Let me try to.
Right. Does that make sense?
It makes perfect sense.
Yeah, it does to me. I've done it often, but nobody knows it's made up. Beautiful, but you know, I have a feeling yet it's a wee bit too slow. Mm-hmm. I think it's a little bit too slow for you. It's a little bit slow for me. But then this one can never say with tempos. You know, should this be 89 to the quarter note or 74? I mean, who knows? I mean, it can be anything. But I think for me it's a bit slow, and I think for you it's a bit slow. But oh, mio babbino ca. I would have meant to be babbino ca. I would. Not as marked, but I would do it anyway. That we have the license to do. Sure.
Oh, mio babbino caro.
But before pia, you stop. Your mi pia. You already say this p, and your mouth closes, and you no sound. Mi pia. No. Mi pia. Mi pia. Tra. Ba. Lo. Ba. Right there. Mio
babbino.
But what about this? Oh, mio babbino. What's the difference between my mio and yours?
Mine's shorter, probably.
You go, oh, mio babbino. I don't know what, I have no idea what you're saying. It's like, oh, mio babbino. The E is the longer part of the two.
Okay.
The longer, oh, mio babbino. By a 264th note, it's longer. Doesn't matter, but it's the stressed part of the vowel. Okay?
Oh, mio babbino.
Bravo. in all. Great, super. At all. Me begotten. What is comparar?
That means, here's daddy. He pleases me, he's handsome. I want to buy the ring.
Right, to buy the ring.
Yeah. Or
Porta
like
Rosa.
There.
I want to go to the Porta Rosa.
And I want
to buy to buy the ring. That's what I'm going to do.
Where do you want me to start?
Wherever you want. You start, we'll come. Don't worry about us, we'll find you.
Oh, mio bambino
caro,
mi piace bello,
bello,
portare a porta rossa, a governare l'anello, si ci
doing great with the legato. Now you'll stop. What on earth is this now? Oh, A, B, C. Who cares? What does it mean?
I'm gonna, I want to go there.
No, we did that already. And if I should love him in vain.
Oh, yeah.
Say la masi andarono. Doesn't matter. I'll go anyway and buy it. It doesn't matter. Say la masi andarono.
That's right there.
Yes, absolutely.
No,
you, and then you're out to lunch. Hey, I don't know where you go. You're going out.
Will you start before that then so I can get it?
I mean,
yeah, that would be perfect.
Stop. This is a double unvoice. What am I going to do if I go to the Ponte Vecchio? I'm going to throw myself into the river. Ma per buttarmi là. But if I go there in vain, if he doesn't love me anymore, then I'll just go to the bridge and I'll jump in and I'll drown myself. Ma per buttarmi là.
Ma per buttarmi.
Yeah, but don't go butta. That doesn't make any expression. Butta. That's cheap. Ma per buttarmi, a real expression. That's cheap.
Ma per buttarmi,
double R, vorrei. That's ours forever, this wobble.
Okay.
Forever, it's a wobble. Mori, baba, ri, baba, babbo, piena. Great.
Babbo pietà.
That makes no sense. Babbo pietà. Babbo is a bubble bee. And that's right, you're right there. But then you make everything. Babbo pietà. No. Babbo pietà. Oh, please, please, please. That's what he's doing. Babbo pietà.
Babbo
pietà. Good. Great ending too. Just blah 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 blah. Thanks.
Oh, okay.
Very good. Hello.
Hi.
What's your name?
I'm Ryan.
You're Ryan? And what are you going to sing?
Amir.
Amir? Schubert Amir?
Yep.
Oh, great. It's one of the great songs, of which there are many. Oh, that key. Okay.
Das Meer erglänzt weit hinaus.
Ryan, the song is, in a way, is long, but what is the tempo marking that Schubert gives us for this song?
I believe it's sehr langsam.
Sehr langsam. And if you look at all the 600 and plus Schubert songs, this happens very rarely that he says sehr langsam. Mm-hmm. And also, is it in four or two?
It's in two.
It's in four, isn't it? Is it not? What edition do you have? That's wrong. It's not right. It's in four.
Okay.
It's not cut time. But one, two, three. But really slow. But it's one of the slowest songs in the whole canon.
Okay.
Can you?
I'll give it a try. We'll see how it goes.
Okay. But I don't know what edition this is, but that's cool. It's not cut time.
All right.
One, two, three, and four. And there comes the fermata.
Das Meer. Das Unglück selbst gewahr.
Yeah, Ryan, tell us what this poem is about.
I'm there, meaning by the sea, so I'm sitting by the sea with my lover. We're sitting in a very silent and still place by a fisherman's house, and suddenly the fog rises and the water begins to swell. There's a seagull flying all over the place, and her emotion begins to reflect the sea, and her eyes swell up. She begins to weep bitterly, and my soul is consumed with this sadness that she's feeling, and ultimately I'm poisoned by her tears.
Yeah, how does he get poisoned by the tears?
Yeah.
How does he get the tears?
Because they fall onto her hand and then come onto my knee.
Well, he takes them away from her hands.
Right, I drink them from that hand.
Absolutely. Now, can you manage this slowly? It's slow. It's very difficult.
It's much slower than I'm used to, yeah.
Yeah, love it. But this is right. You have to be slow.
Sure.
Let's try again.
Okay.
Before, what should you be doing when we hear these chords before? What should be going through you at that time?
A slow breath, what I'm about to be singing, the words in the piece?
Eighth notes.
Okay.
Eighth notes are the body, but and you think, I'm going to let them hear one last mirror. But they've been going on all the time. But I don't want this to sound, okay, one, two, three. Das Meer, that's no good. But we body Das Meer. Are you with me?
Okay.
They're going all the time. Two. We sat there by this lonely, kind of all by itself, fishing cabin.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So we were going. What's not good about Einsamen?
What
is not good about Einsamen?
I kind of sat on the second syllable.
I don't think you sat on it, but the second syllable is not good. But why was it not good?
I'm not sure.
Because you disconnected everything. You
okay.
You were doing great. Einsamen. That's not it. Einsamen. What am I doing?
You're connecting.
I'm singing. I'm singing. That's what singing is about. That's what singing is about. Wir saßen einsam. Okay.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Wir saßen einsam in Fischerhaus. Wir saßen stumm.
There you are, finally. Yeah, finally. Whole alphabet, but then we got there. Wir saßen stumm und alleine.
Yeah.
Ja, wir saßen stumm. Great, except you go, der Ne, there's no accent. Der Ne, Maschi, the fog rolls up. Mm-hmm. Okay? Bravo. Three, four, der Ne, Maschi. The Möwe flew here and wieder. The eagle flew back and forth.
From the Möwe?
Yeah, yeah, okay, fine. What was the train, the tears doing?
Falling.
Feeling, huh?
Yeah.
That's right there.
Feeling.
Is that not another fee? It's closed, that's E. Feeling. Is that falling, but fell? That's the past tense. Feeling. Feeling. I'm together. Ich sah sie fallen. Bravo, bravo. Ah, sie fallen auf deine Hand
und bin aufs Knie gesunken.
Gives you I think the rule doesn't have an exception, if that could really be. But what shows us that it's really close? Erzählt sich mein Leib.
The
H. When H comes after these vowels, I think without exception they are closed.
Okay.
Erzählt sich mein Leib. Otherwise we think now it's probably open. But E. It seems this my life. Mm-hmm. Begin again with the trombone. It's damn good too, boy. great. The wrong words. I couldn't find my place. Oh, yeah, okay. But. Very good. Right. Remember, we'll work on this solo because I really think it's the right tempo.
Okay.
Yeah. So, how many of you are study German, have German class? And, you know, I think one of the hardest things to learn in German is the prepositions. The prepositions are very difficult. And when do they take dative? When do they take accusative? When can they take either one, depending on what's going on? But I'll never forget. When I don't know what class I was in, when I learned how to memorize the prepositions that take dative, all that they're the fewest, so these easy ones to remember. Prepositions that take dative. Does anybody know how to do this? I learned it both. I've forgotten what class I was in, but also a class in Germany. Aus, außer, bei, mit, nach, seit, von, zu. You know the first two phrases of the Blue Danube Waltz, and you're aus, außer, bei, mit, nach, seit. One, two. Those are the seven prepositions. They take dative, no matter what happens. So I always think about that. It helps.
Yeah, I remember that in German class.
You do? You did learn that?
Yep.
Yeah. Well, it's just vital. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's one of the things to learn because it's not easy to learn all the rules. Mm-hmm. And I forget some, I'm sure, but I was also admit that I don't forget. Thanks, Ryan.
Thank you. Zachary Lutz, and I will be singing Una Amorosa.
Oh, see, cozy. No.
Sure. tesoro, dolce ristoro, al cuor porgerà una amorosa del nostro tesoro, un dolce ristoro al cuor porgerà, un dolce ristoro al cuor porgerà.
Very good, Zach. Tell us, I think there are maybe six lines of text in this aria. Tell us what he has to say, what they have to say.
I am singing to my lover, who I've just successfully wooed. and I'm saying, a breath, an amorous breath for of our treasure, a sweet refreshment to our heart, to the heart which nourished by hope and by love has no need of any food, any better food.
Right. Do you know where it comes in the opera?
Yeah, it's in scene two, I believe, and my friend, we're both trying to woo each other's lovers to test them and see if they're faithful. And he has just failed, and this is, I've essentially succeeded, and this is that.
You know, Cozy has tons of words, you know, that tons of recitativo, and it goes on and on and on, talk, and then there comes, I think it's very hard to sing this part, because all of a sudden, comes this bum bum, and there's the tenor, just stand still, and sing this very difficult aria, and I think it's the only time in the whole opera, really, that things are sort of quiet, and all he does is sing, that this is really hard, and I think so too, bum bum. Now, you take two, think about these eight notes before you begin. Una rosa, legatissimo all the time. Come on, we're going to find our way.
Okay.
Amoroso only has one M. You go, amor, una rosa. What am I doing before mo?
Connecting.
Well, I'm singing ah. That's what, then I say mo. Sing all the time. He's singing to his friend, singing to Guglielmo. And he said, this wonderful, this loving breath that comes from our treasure. Mm-hmm. And why is this plural? Because he has a treasure too, the other boy. Guglielmo has the other girl, Torrebella. See, but it comes, this breath that comes from our treasure. Del nostro tesoro. We wondered before, why is this, why isn't he saying, del mio tesoro? But from our, from both of us. This breath that comes from both of our lovers. Una aura amorosa. Come on, begin again. Tell me,
una aura amorosa del nostro tesoro.
Absolutely, you have the right answer. Right answer. Wow. You're at the top of the class. That's what it's all about.
Yeah.
Don't stop in front of it. The Corps Gera. I'm so lost, I don't know where
the book
is. What a big, big page.
Yes.
I think the score I learned from it was smaller. Oh, it's huge. Un dolce ristoro.
Un dolce ristoro.
I don't know if you'll find the story interesting or funny, but a long time ago, I think I was in Kansas City with Mr. Pavarotti, and this was on the program. And we went to the hall before to rehearse, and we went through a few things, and he came to Del Cor, and this F sharp was just a crack. It was nothing. He said, friend, this is enough, no more today. So we canceled the concert. It was F sharp, we come just to the passaggio, and he said, well, it's not right. So we stopped. So now I'm thinking about that. Now yours is wonderful. But it just reminded me of that. So we stopped and we went back to it 6 months later. Un dolce ristoro.
Un dolce ristoro. Al cor porgerà. Un aroma.
We're all like that. I was set. Yeah, right. Okay.
Al cor porgerà.
Bravo. What does it mean?
Nourishment.
Nourished, right. Fed by. To the heart, which is nutrito, which is fed by. This will have a good esca. But just break these trills.
Sure.
Don't close the M until we need to say the next beat. Okay. I'm singing, period. Dunesca migliore. Come on. Easy down to octaves.
Dunesca migliore.
Bravo.
Bisogno non ha. Bisogno non ha. Bisogno non ha.
Don't you do ah? I would put those in.
I could do those, yes.
Yeah, why not? You know, some people say whole cadenzas, and I wouldn't do that. But mm-hmm. I would put the D sharp and the D in. Ah,
sure.
I mean, it's a question of taste.
Yeah.
That my taste is to do them, and some may not like it. That's okay. Don't say no. I can't find the place. Oh, right. Bees on yours.
Bees on yours.
Take your time, you could say, well, my time is faster. Okay. I have to agree with that. But I think it wants to be slower. Take your time. Questions, I will be very happy to try and answer them, but I hope they're not too hard because it'll be embarrassing for everybody.
So. I did want to ask.
Please.
This emphasis, and I couldn't help but notice that Robert Shaw was a big influence in your career. And of course, Robert Shaw talked about that internalization of the rhythm quite a lot.
Right.
And I just wonder if you could just sort of. Just kind of expound on that principle a little bit about its central importance and how it, you know, what singers need to be thinking all the time as it relates to that sort of thing.
Well, yeah, I think it's vital, and it's as I tried to say earlier, people want to say is a great singer in the world. I am now talking about the most famous and what are known as the greatest singers. I think without fail, they all have this. Whether they are aware of it or not, I have no idea. I've known a few of them, but I've not known them all. But they are really making sound every millisecond that they're standing on their feet and that their mouths are open. It's absolutely vital that they make this sound all the time. And that, Mr. Shaw's idea of all the inner rhythm, I remember it from those days, it had more to do with everybody being together. And that's another story. When you conduct a chorus where there are 200 people, or even only 20 people, it's vital that they all move from C to D at the same time. Or they all say the letter T at the same time. And make that vital. And I think that's what that was about. My stress is to just make sound. And to keep going with this vowel that you have chosen, we hope it's the right one. But you'll find this out in your lives too. There are different ideas about vowels, about what the A sounds like, what A sounds like, when they should be open, they should be closed. I understand that. Some of these are just
are ideas, that different people have different ideas. I'm not saying mine are, they're right for me. I am not going to change. And I don't, it's not open to discussion. Never. It's why I said to Scott in the beginning and the end of this class, I do not do French in these classes. My French is really quite good, but it's not perfect, and I refuse to argue about it with anybody. I do not want somebody to say, well, in high school, the teacher said we'd only lie to you, or we do lie there, or this is closed and this is open. I don't choose to discuss it, because I don't think anybody really knows. other things that I firmly believe in, and I will discuss, and you can do as you want. But that's what I think about this inner rhythm. I think it helps. I've seen it work. I've seen it work with countless students, the singers, that if they really concentrate on making all the inner rhythm, and think about a quarter note, generally, somebody will say, well, the tempo is so slow, it's really worth 8/32nds. Well, I understand that. But we just say a quarter note is usually worth 4/16ths. If you think it's worth 4/16ths of sound, and that these 4/16ths each have a life of its own, and it makes the notes alive. It makes your singing worth listening to. And that has nothing to do with the quality of your voice. That's something for you and for the teacher to decide on. And the quality, that's a matter of opinion. But is it legato? It's not a matter of opinion. It's a fact. Either you are or you are not. It's just that. It's like being in tune. Some people would say, well, you know, I didn't hear that it was flat. Well, then you don't listen well. If it's flat, it's flat. I mean, the try with the piano. The piano, this one seems to be well in tune, but that it's not a question of, it's not open to discussion. This is a fact. Okay. Did I satisfy you?
Well, the difference there between Shaw talking about that inner rhythm being for being together, and I think you've taken that to a new level, which is kind of exciting to think about.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think it's fabulous. I'm dealing really only with one singer at a time.
Right.
So I don't have, I'm not thinking about everybody saying letter T at the same time,
right,
or everybody all having the same vowel, which is vital. I understand that. And I have been with Mr. Shaw in countless of these community choruses. I for one, I'm so in favor of community choruses, I cannot tell you. I think it's just vital to our life. And I don't like when they don't exist. But that's really, I think, what his inner rhythm business was about.
Right.
Yeah. Yes. Okay.
Question.
Yes.
Mr. Wustman, I think I pronounced that right.
Sure, that's fine.
Okay, I have the range from a bass.
I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
Oh, I said I got a range from a bass. Expand that range by using falsettos when needed. How do you actually get to use falsettos when you get to those notes that are just outside of the range?
I wish I could answer you, but I can't. It's not within the realm of my knowledge, I have to tell you that. But I think you're lucky if you can sing falsetto. I would do it. But this, again, that is a problem for a person who calls himself a voice teacher. I don't call myself that. And so that's a voice teacher's, supposed to be his, he's supposed to be able to know how to do that. And maybe you can't find, maybe those notes are not in your throat, maybe they're not on your chords. But I understand, it can go so high and then it goes into falsetto. You were lucky it could go into falsetto. I'm sorry, I don't have an answer. Yes?
We didn't have any American art songs performed today, but do you have any favorite American compositions that we might look into?
I wish I had more, and I think it was one of the failings of my life that I didn't spend more time doing it. I mean, there are lots of things that I think are beautiful. I love the songs of Sam Barber, for instance. Aaron Copland, I like some songs, and there are other songs that I like. I do not know a lot of them, and I'm sorry to admit that, but I don't. I'm sure there are many. I just don't know them.
Many here may not realize that Mr. Wustman, for the centenary of Franz Schubert's, was it 7 years ago?
Pardon me?
He performed all 630 of Schubert's songs in a series of recitals over the course of 7 years. So the entire, he didn't miss one single song, all 630, all over the country. So for Schubert's songs, there should be.
It was great. I wish I could go back and do it all over again. We did it for Schubert's 200th birthday. Anyway, it occurred to me in the late 1980s, I thought, that would really be great to do. People are always celebrating composers or somebody's death. And why don't we celebrate somebody's birth? And so I thought, well, I think I'll do Schubert, since Schubert was born in 97. I thought, well, then this was already 88 or 89 that the thought occurred to me. I thought, well, if I'm going to do it, I better start now. I'm just saying, and 630 songs, I don't know. You can read all kinds of stories and ideas as to how many Schubert songs there are. The number varies. It all depends on how you count them. So I'm just saying 630. I think we did about 630, maybe 628, I don't know. There's some, for instance, we did for Edna this morning in the Breitkopf edition of the complete Schubert. There are 5 versions of for Edna. And they are very, very much alike. In some version, there's a dotted quarter instead of a quarter. And not one of them has that introduction printed. And so if you count each one of these with a dotted quarter as another song, then you come up with more than 630 eventually. And but some, it's the same with Verdi operas. Some people say there are 27, some say 28, some say there are 29. It just depends on how you count. So I don't. But you're right to say about 630. That's what we did, and it was just great. I did it with students, and this changed. It took 6.5 years to do it, and so one student was there from the beginning until the end, and that was Nathan. He came as a freshman, and then he stayed. He was never a graduate student, but he did some after he finished. So that's all that was. We were here once, I think we were at Calvin College. Yeah. Once or twice, I cannot remember,
yeah,
with the Schuberts.
Yep.
Do you remember?
Yep.
Was it twice?
You were at Grand Valley and at Calvin.
And we were at Grand Valley also, yes.
Yep.
And I believe also at Hope in 1997 with
Yep.
Gun.
Yep, right, we were at Hope also.
When you do a big project like that, you know, the scope of it is so huge, you know, and from start to finish, it is all joy for you. Is there a particular joy that it brought you that you didn't anticipate?
Well, I don't think I anticipated any of it. It was, but it was pure joy. I mean, absolutely. And I had no idea how it would work out. And what really surprised me is, a few years after that. I retired, and I think maybe one of the first years that I was retired, I went to Vienna to, I think I taught 6 weeks there at the conservatory, and I met the president, and he was very nice and very pleasant, and just this usual kind of talk, and well, what have you been doing, and blah, 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 blah. And I said, the biggest thing I did in the last few years was, I said, we did all the Schubert songs. And I said, you probably had several versions of this here in Vienna. He said, no, he said, I don't think there was one. I was really surprised. I don't think he was trying to make something up. But I thought there would be many. But I have never heard of another one. And I'm not saying that there wasn't one. It's probably there wasn't. I just haven't heard of it. But it was well worth everything. Yes, sir.
Can you talk a bit about the collaborative process between accompanist and singer and the importance of that and how you work with them?
Yeah, I have to tell you, collaborative is a word that just makes my blood boil. that's okay, it can boil for a few minutes. I don't like this new idea of trying to change the word accompanist to collaborative artist or collaborative whatever. I don't like it at all. But It's difficult to say. You know, there are two. For me, there were two positions. One, either I was the teacher, and then those of you who teach know, then what you say is law, and that's why you teach. And the student listens, and he does or she does what you tell him to, and if he doesn't, then he can get out and find somebody else. Otherwise, there's no point in teaching. And so that's one way. So all the Schuberts we did then, that way, but then all the other singers I played for whose names I need not mention, were world famous or whatever not. There was really, I can't even say there was any, what one would call rehearsing. I think rehearsing is an overused word, number one. We just do it, and generally, I have to say, in my life, there was never anything to say. I mean, somebody would say, well, John, I really think I have to do this a little bit faster. I can't get through in one breath unless we go a little bit faster. Okay, so go a little bit faster. Oh, this is a little bit too fast for me. I can't get these notes. Go a little bit slower. That's about it. But I think this word rehearsing in the school situation, at least in my school, is just grossly, grossly overused and misused. What it is, and I don't mean to be putting anybody or any kind of people down, but really it's generally what it is a time for the singers to learn the notes and to learn the music and to memorize. I understand that. I quite understand that. If I were singing, I would have to have somebody play the piano while I sang and found my notes and kept going to memorize. Okay, that's one thing. But I don't think that's rehearsing. And I just don't think there's really much of what we think is rehearsing going on in the world in much of anything. I think about the big orchestras, which I don't know much about, most of it in New York, the Philharmonic. You can't say that it rehearsed anything. They would have a rehearsal, that maybe a new conductor would come and they'd do the ending and say, okay, that's that. Or he'd say, we don't do repeats after this, and, okay, that's that. Or if there was a new work, which sometimes appeared, then this has to be practiced and rehearsed. But otherwise, I just don't think there's, I think it's a word that's just grossly overused. Did I answer you well enough?
I'd like to just delve into then what the true rehearsing is for you.
What true rehearsing is? I think I don't know how to answer that.
You know, aside of rehearsing being learning the notes of the singer to memorize, now two artists come together and have a piece before them that they have to work through and bring their ideas and their musical senses together and their meanings and all of that together. Is that when you refer to that there's not enough true rehearsing going on?
Yeah, I suppose that's rehearsing, but it's, and I listened to you ask the question, I think always, if we're talking now about songs or arias, but primarily songs, and if two people are, one singer and one pianist, the problem is probably goes without saying that one is perhaps more experienced or stronger than the other, or more experienced with that particular piece or that particular style of pieces. And so what I think the only thing that happens then is that the other person has to adjust like immediately. And I don't think, this is my experience in all my years of doing it, it wasn't a question, well, let's try this a little bit slower and see how it goes. Well, I think that's a little bit, well, let's try that. I never in my life went through that, never. Somebody would say, John is too fast. Okay, so I go slower. That's that. Or it's too slow, I go faster. Yes, Scott.
Last night you said something interesting that I think our different colleges and universities that are here might enjoy hearing from you, and that's we all do theatrical productions of some sort, whether it's uh-huh. musical or opera. And where you think the energies are wisely spent and where the energies and monies are not wisely spent, that'd just be good for all
this is, again, just my opinion, and I don't know much about all schools. I know some things about my school. And I love opera, as I'm sure you all know. And when I hear that the opera productions cost so many thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars, I'm horrified. And I think it's money wasted. Because I don't think that we have to spend that much money on the costumes and on the sets. I think, for me, that's what I told you last night, and I know you're not maybe you all think I'm crazy, but I see no point in spending $20,000 for somebody's costumes. When I think just as well, they could just get the choir robes in Front Street Baptist and dye them red or black or blue, and red is for the wedding and black is for the funeral and white is for confirmation or something. And then basta, let that be enough. And I don't think we have to spend all the money on the sets and on the costume. I think it absolutely is money wasted. But I know that the people who are running opera at my school, they are interested really in selling tickets to the public. Okay, that's something else. But I don't think that as an educational institution that is should be our biggest responsibility in studying an opera or putting on an opera production. I don't think that we should think, okay, we have to sell so and so many tickets in order to fill the hall and to make enough money to pay our expenses. I think what we have to really be primarily and only concerned with is teaching the music and teaching the opera to these students. That's really what we are there to do. If we give a performance of it, that's fine too. And if people buy tickets and come, that's fine. Or let's give tickets away, who cares? Just give them away if you want people to come. Of course it's wonderful to have audiences there, but if we don't, we don't. That's what I was trying to say to you last night. Yes, sir.
I asked this question with trepidation, but when you were just discussing this issue of rehearsing, and I certainly had plenty of experiences where there has been this, okay, we're going to go a little faster, we're going to get a little slower, we're going to do this, that. And I've always asked myself as a conductor and as a singer, where does the music come in? Where is that in the rehearsing? Do the performers bring that in as they work together? Does it somehow happen?
I think I don't quite understand your question.
Yeah, I'm not sure I understand it either. I've just always felt like with the whole concept of rehearsing that we seem to value a great deal our detachment from that, from what I'm saying. And so somehow, it seems to me the value of rehearsing is to somehow create that thing that is then going to move the listener, as you mentioned earlier.
Well, I think you were right.
And I'm just wondering where that comes from when we rehearse, and how do we capture that in that time, other than just going faster or slower? Or
I don't think I can answer you. I don't think there is an answer.
Okay.
And it happens.
Yeah. Okay, that's a good answer.
Well, I mean, I don't think one can say, well, do this and do that.
Sure.
There is no such thing.
When you are playing as an accompanist, which you've done so many times, and are working with a singer, who's leading who?
I think the truth is that the pianist is almost always leading, because that's why it's vital. It's the piano, as you will know, in almost everything, has all the moving notes. And it's vital that the singer agrees, or that you do what the singer wants or can do. But the piano had, I think everything we did this morning, the piano has the most notes and therefore is leading. There's just no other way to say it. I once said, you know, if you are following, that really means that you are behind. But then some wiseacre said, yes, but if you're leading, it means you are ahead. that shut me up for a minute. But I suppose that is true. But that's what those verbs do. But following ideally these things happen together. But the piano has the most notes. And so therefore, it is showing the tempo. That makes common sense. Yes, sir.
Do you have words of advice for someone who might be aspiring to be an accompanist as to what kind of training is best, what kind of experience is best?
No, it's just to study the repertoire and
I've been teaching it now for all these years, and I should be able to say this and that is the training, but I just can't. And sadly, I think what has happened, I don't think there are many accompanists left in the world. I mean, song singing and giving recitals with piano, really, I think is just disappearing. Don't you?
Seems like it.
I mean, it still exists in schools. I know that, and where people take courses and whatever. But since I was a teenager, I have read the New York Times every day. I didn't read it today because I don't know where to find it here, but it'll be home waiting for me. But I've just been struck the last 10 years or so. Well, just this last, I get my newspaper late. A few days ago, I got the Labor Day weekend, the fall, the big Sunday Times that tells them what's coming on in the season, the musical season of note. I looked, not one song recital, not one, in New York. And it's been this way for about 10 years, just not one. And I read the Times every day, and it just doesn't exist anymore.
Well, New York Festival of Song still kicks.
That still exists, right. And of course, those are wonderful, the song recitals, but I just don't see anything else.
Right.
But that's very specialized,
right.
It is.
Right.
But I don't see anything. And I remember the years, not so long ago, when I probably played more in New York than most of the other people did, but when I played 9 or 10 concerts a season. And that's 9 or 10 at Carnegie Hall or Philharmonic Hall. There's big recitals, and that I don't see. I mean, this New York, what is it called again? I forgot.
Festival of Song.
Festival of Song. Yeah. And they're not really students, but they're not known people.
Right.
They're very good. I'm not putting it down at all. But think about who the famous singers at the Met are today. I don't see one of them giving a recital. A song recital, it doesn't exist. And 20 years ago, I'm telling you, it did. Because I played for most of them. And it just doesn't exist. And I don't, we have a big recital series at school, at the University of Illinois. And it's been several years now since there's been any solo singer of any kind who appears on it. I don't think it's just falling away. And part of it is for good reason. Part of it is because many towns like you in Grand Rapids, you have opera company. And again, when I was your age, there was no opera company. There was the Met, and there was Chicago was short, and that was about it. But now there are opera companies everywhere. And I think it's great. I love it. But I think it has taken away from the feeling for and the needing of solo recitals. Have you had one here in Grand Rapids? No. I mean, aside from your own faculty, which I'm sure are all wonderful, I don't mean to put anybody down, but just to take a name from the present day, has Renee Fleming been here giving a recital? No. And or Stephanie Blythe, or any of these people?
What about Liederabend in Germany?
Pardon me?
What about Liederabend in Germany and Austria?
I don't know because I never lived there, but I've been told it also is not as it once was. I don't know, but I have not lived there. Anything else? I'm going to say goodbye and thank you very much. I've enjoyed the show.
Thank you.